All right, guys. I'm Big Mike, and like always, I'd like to thank you for joining today. Today we have another Ask Me Anything session with Futures Trader 71. The AMAs are designed to be quick and casual. There's no prepared presentation. We're going to limit the session to 30 minutes. And the recording will be posted on VMT after the AMA is over. Go ahead and start typing your questions now, and we'll get everybody's questions answered if we have time. And turn things over to FT.
Hey, Mike, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Excellent. All right, let me turn on my screen, get this ball rolling. Not that you need to see my screen. First, I'd like to say trading futures, options on futures, and spot FX involves substantial risk of loss and is not suitable for all investors. Past performance is not indicative of future results.
All right.
What questions do we have, Mike?
Let's take a look. Jeff says, can you go over how you arrive at weekly projected ranges? It seems that you use the open to low high for one data set and use 34 points of normal range for another. Can you explain how you use this and how you arrive at these numbers?
Okay. It's probably a lengthy subject for today, but let me show you what I'm doing. I'm assuming you can see my screen, right?
Yeah, we got it.
Let's see. Nope, that's not the chart. Oh, it's this one. All right. So I've done studies that I can share with you here. I got tons and tons and tons of studies based on market information. So this is one right here. All I've done here is looked at the opening price on a weekly, the high and the low. And I'm computing the open to the high and open to the low. The difference between those is the range, basically. The range is high to low. And I've plotted and figured out what is the most common and what is considered normal range, which is one sigma or 68% of the data set. What is the most common range from the open to the high over the last, whatever, since 2005? Okay, long period, 422 weeks. That's a pretty good sample size. And then I figure out what is the mode or the point of control. I figure out what the extent is of this data set to get to one standard deviation. I do the same for, I do this to the high, and I do this to the low, open to low, open to high. Okay? And so when the week starts, I throw on the weekly open, and then I put on the open to high and open to low stats based on this spreadsheet. I look at the most common and I look at the extent that it can go to. So the most common is open to 6 points above on the weekly, but the it could be anywhere from 1 point to 24 point. That is considered normal. That represents approximately 70% of the time the markets within that range. So I project these open to high, open to low, and I throw them on this chart. So that's where you get 18.10 above, which actually, if you look at the 18.10, let me shrink this a bit. On the weekly, it pretty much gives us a pretty good area because this upper channel is 18.05 or so. And an 18 below, it's 17.81. That is the narrowest range. If it breaches it, then what I do is go to the extreme range. I throw on 24 on the top, 29 on the bottom. In addition to this, I do a separate study on just the weekly range. Like, what is the plain old weekly range? And I have a spreadsheet for that. And that is just simply a spreadsheet here that tests what is the most common weekly range in the S&P. Again, This is a shorter range study to 2009, 201 weeks studied, and the most common weekly range is between 20 and 48, with or the range the most likely or the most normal is 20 points to 48. The most likely is 34. So once I put the open to high and open to low, I double check to see how many points that is, and if it's within that range, I keep it up. As soon as it's breached, I expand it to either 34 points wide or those other levels that I gave you from the open to the high and open to the low. Is this gospel? Is this the Holy Grail? Is it something where I'll sell it as soon as it gets there? Absolutely not. These are what I would call gross yardsticks. They're just big pieces that I put on there that count as a measuring stick, just like a construction guy will use his feet to determine how many yards, you know, a distance is. It's not accurate, but it just gives you a general idea of where we would be for the week. And then essentially what I do is use this research chart to zoom in. This is a 16-minute chart. I use it to zoom into those zones. Like, what do I have between 1810 and 1781? One of the key areas is right here, actually, at 1781. The second key area is between 1773 and 1770 and a half, which 1770 and a half was the yearly high before this chop zone that we were in for most of October and the beginning of November. So I expect this area to get retested if we continue to sell lower, except I see a very weak high up top. This is not the kind of high we put in usually when the market's exhausted and prices have reached an extreme. This is not a blow-off top of any kind. So I think we're likely to come back and take out the 1800. I can't imagine we'd move to 1800 and just walk away from it with a one tick test. That's too clean for me. But that's basically the process.
Okay, Rex is asking, he says, many times we'll gap up and you'll say your primary hypothesis is responsive selling. However, you often say that you're expecting a push up after the open before expecting responsive selling. Can you elaborate on what is driving that expectation for a further push up?
Okay, so one of the things I have to look at as part of the morning homework, and I'm doing my homework online. I'm doing it offline, but I'm sharing the process online in what I call Trader Bites, which I post every morning on YouTube. You just need to look for my name on YouTube and you'll see a whole page of them. And one of the things I look at is what has it done overnight and what is the inventory overnight? What is most likely to be off overnight? Who's going to be offsides overnight? Who's most likely to be? For example, yesterday we came in and opened right in here above. This is the overnight session right here. The profile with the blue, this box here, is the overnight session. This is the day session. This is what we did yesterday. Chop, 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 chop. Plosser comes out. Market gets dinged a little bit. ICANN comes out and says there's significant risk to owning stocks. Boom, the NASDAQ leads us down. So that's yesterday. The night before, if you look at the inventory here, it's sideways. The inventory is flat, and then it starts to get long. The inventory starts to get long. You see it here in the delta. Let me expand this pane here. You can see the delta. There are more people lifting the offer than hitting the bid, therefore getting pretty long into the open. This bar here is the open, this red bar. So the inventory is quite a bit on the long side. The expectation when that happens is that if you got long anywhere in here, or if you were long into the close the day before and you come in and you see that it's gapped up, your inclination is to be risk averse and to take some profits. And that's going to cause responsive selling. Responsive meaning the market's moving towards the latest or the last value that has been put in, which was below, which was down here that night. And so we expect responsive selling. However, if the market just chops around moves up and chops around and this stays kind of flat, then the overnight inventory, yeah, it's above the prior day. So technically, according to Stadelmeyer, the guy who invented Market Profile, and Dalton, who teaches it, you know, the inventory is long because price is above. I don't agree with that. If price is above, yet delta is sitting here, the volume delta is flat, it's pretty much that energy is dissipated. I expect it to try higher before rotating back. In either case, I expect it to retest the top of the prior day's range. There's a much higher probability it would retest the prior day's range than for it to open, chop around, and keep going. The only circumstance under which it opens and just takes off is what's called an open drive. And those are the days, you know, if the market opens and just runs away from the prior day's price range, those are the days where you have to staple your buying hand or selling hand, if it's upwards, to the table or to the chair and not trade if you tend to fade trades. Because if you have a buyer right from the get-go, that's what's considered the third force or the other time frame player or the bigger player, bigger participant. You don't want to fade that guy. In most circumstances, that's someone who's going to continue to buy and continue to buy and continue to buy and continue to buy. But if it opens up choppy and it's just sitting sideways, chances are with a gap, I'll go back to the day session so you can see the gaps. Like here, yesterday's high is 96, or the Friday high is 96. Yesterday it opens, it gaps up. It's likely to test the top of the range or push into the range to significant areas. You can see yesterday it pushed to the what's called the LVN or the low volume node, and boom, buyer comes in, could not get into the next distribution. Buyer comes in, tries to push higher, could not make it, and now there's an incentive to buy, there's an incentive to sell. You have the 1800 behind you and you have a rejection of yesterday's range, so what do you get? Boom, 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 chop. Until something causes the market to revalue the product and then it's sold off. So that's the process. It's not necessary that there's going to be responsive selling on a gap up immediately or responsive buying on a gap down immediately. It just depends, you know, that's a factor, but the additional factor is what has it done as far as volume? Who was the most aggressive player on that gap? Did they flatten out? And that's what the volume delta tells you down here. It shows you how many lifted at the offer minus how many hit at the bid to give you the net position for the aggressive traders that participated in that session.
Okay. Chris is asking, do you primarily take trades with expectation of moving back into value?
No. Because there are two conditions to the market. One, the market can be in balance, so it's choppy. Like today is sort of a balancing market. We opened in range. Here's the opening price. It says right here 1788 and a quarter, right inside of yesterday's range, outside of its value, right below its value. My trader bite this morning, you can go check it and compare it to what's happened so far. My expectation is for a chop. I expect the low to be tested at some point, which it did early, but I expect chop and I expect it to trade through this thin zone. And my target this morning was 92.50 and it got to it fairly early on. So this is a balance condition. In this condition, I am trading towards balance or towards value. But the other condition that the market can be in is a trending condition, which is what's called imbalance. And it has certain characteristics in that it opens, it only tests one side. It does not push both ways, whereas today's open pushed both ways. So if we look at today's open, see this, it open, test up, test down, test up, break, comes right back into the opening swing, which are these blue lines, which is the it delineates the first up and down. It shows you where sellers started participating and where buyers started participating from the get-go. As soon as it gets back in here, I expect it to cross, testing 92.50 right here, got to 92.75, chop, 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 push higher, and now we're in this again, balancing mode. So today, I'm looking for trades that are likely to break higher, but then be met with selling. I expect trades to break lower, then be met with buying, but constantly kind of moving back towards the middle until this is kind of fat and has the energy to just push in one direction. The thing that's elusive with this method that you have to kind of hone in on, and is always a guess, as all methods are guessing methods because we're playing probabilities, is what condition is the market in? Is it in a balancing condition, or is it in a trending condition? And the market moves from one to the other. It's kind of like driving. You can't say, oh, I always drive in fourth gear. Well, no. Off of a red light, trying to drive in fourth gear will cause your engine to stall. But when do you transition from first to second to third to fourth gear? That's when you're trying. That's when I generally take my losses, because the market's in a transitioning phase, and I need to kind of experience that loss to tell me, okay, watch out, something might be changing here. But other than that, it just depends. I'm not very good with trending days. I don't like trending days. They happen. They don't happen as often. Luckily, except for this year, there are a ton of them. Generally, I like balanced trades because I get very, very defined risk, and I get very, very defined targets because they're moving towards areas that are clear on the profile.
Okay. Rex is asking if you can explain the concept of overnight inventory and the significance of it.
The significance of it. Okay. I think I covered that a little bit. You're just trying to see. I remember overnight inventory, the market overnight does not trade because of, you know, in this example, we're looking at the ES, which is the S&P Mini 500, and it's a market cap based product that is built on 500 stocks. And then if you're trading the Russell, it's a small cap based product built on 2,000 stocks, or the Dow. It's a price weighted, not market cap weighted, but price weighted index that's built on 30 stocks. You have to know what you're trading. You have to understand the product that you're trading. Just like a stock trader looking to get into a stock needs to understand the fundamentals of that stock and futures, you've got to understand what is the product you're trading, what makes it tick, what is it built on. Overnight, those 500 stocks are not trading like they do during the day. There are no arb machines. There are, you know, so essentially what's happening is with this product, it is trading overnight in sympathy with something else. It's trading in sympathy with the Nikkei, with the Hang Seng, with later in the evening with the FTSE, the Euro stocks, the DAX, the CAC 40, whatever, until the book opens here in the U.S., in New York, with the stocks, it's essentially floating along. So what we want to see overnight is what is happening. How are the people who participated in the overnight session, which is right here, how are they positioned? So essentially, last night, price was in the prior day's range, but volume was really staying on the positive side. You can see it did not cross the zero line, but could not hold it. So there, it's no wonder that you get this big move down that balances this, it balances the volume that was very positive. This volume here that's very positive that occurred here, it's not built on any hedge in a stock or offset by a stock basket or anything. It's just inventory that's just too long. It's overnight inventory that's just too long, and it tends to balance itself out. I don't talk about overnight inventory too much because you get into a lot of technical stuff and a lot of questions, but it's important to look at as the market moves higher and can possibly transition into a corrective phase where we've gone so far and everybody and their mother screaming sell, sell, sell as soon as it drops a few points. You want to see, is it legitimate or is it not? And it, again, these are all guesses, but the more probabilities that you stack in your favor, the better.
Okay. TZ is asking if you trade the weekly, and he also wants to know about your interpretation of the VWAP.
I trade intraday. I don't hold positions overnight, generally, not voluntarily at least. If anything, I trade options longer term. That's what I hold for several days or weeks or whatever. But futures, I'm a pure day trader. I'm not interested in, I'm more interested in sleeping than I am interested in holding a position for the long term. So I'm an intraday trader. As far as the VWAP, VWAP is just a measure. Its usefulness really relates to a milestone or a yardstick used by a lot of trade desks around the world to measure the performance of an entry or the performance of the trade desk manager or trader putting on a position for a fund or a bank or whatever. VWAP is the volume weighted average price, and it's just taking volume and price and giving you a weighted value that tracks the day. Right now it's at 89.25, but the most traded price for the day is this pink line here, as you can see it on the profile. That's where the fattest volume is. If I click on that, it's traded 44,113 at that price at 88, looks like 88.50, and the VWAP's at 89.25. So it doesn't represent the most traded price. It just represents an average starting at the open of all the prices and all the volumes that have traded at every price. In other words, volume profiling is just a more accurate depiction of where the volume is. VWAP is just a kind of a guesstimate as to where it is. But if you're a seller, if a fund is a seller and they want to see how did you perform, today you got an order on your desk that says sell 100,000 contracts in the ES as a hedge of something else. The order is going to say give me sell 89 or better. Okay, and then what the VWAP's used for in some of these shops is to measure how well you perform. The more you sell above the VWAP, the better. If you keep selling below VWAP, if you're selling in the hole here at 86, 85, whatever, and VWAP's way behind you, you're selling way below the weighted average price of the market. Another thing that people don't look at often that is used more and more is the time weighted average price, which is a TWAP, but I won't get into that. It's kind of the same concept. It's just a way of measuring performance. You'll find that a lot of volume, a lot of times, goes off right at VWAP, and it tends to hold the market at least temporarily at those prices when it returns to it.
Okay. Speaking of time, I'm going to combine two questions here that had to do with TPO or market profile charts. DeWitt is asking if you incorporate single prints into your trading and what time frame you use to identify them. And Arnie is also asking if you don't you find a TPO chart in conjunction with volume profile to be much better for defining areas of interest instead of using candlestick bars, which could produce way too much noise?
Okay, so I have a volume profiling, a market profile chart that I use. This happens to be the weekly because I'm monitoring the overall health of this latest run-up. I do look at it, but I trigger off of volume because time doesn't matter to me. A regular volume or a regular TPO-based chart is breaking down the market in brackets of 30 minutes. Each one of these boxes represents 30 minutes. Why 30 minutes? Why not 5? Why not 15? Why not 60? Doesn't matter. In general, wherever there's a single print, I have an LVN. I'm more over time, and this is since 2005, over time I've noticed that the market is much more likely to test and check an LVN than it is a single print. These light blue lines right here, these are a single print. This is the beginning of a single print right here. So you see where there's a single print, this is a volume profile, this is a TPO chart based on 30-minute brackets. Where there's a single print, there's an LVN. Where there's a single print, there's an LVN. You know, and that's how it works. However, on a day like today where there wasn't a single print, there's still an LVN here. Okay, and on the other side, there's an LVN down here, single print, LVN, single print starts, LVN starts. Single print stops, here's the top of your LVN zone, on and on and on. I get more information, more detail out of a volume profile than I do a regular market profile chart. Market profiles make things a little bit neater to look at because they're just blocks of time. But I prefer to see what's there, and the market gives us enough information to see volume, so why not use that? It's really a preference thing. They're both telling you almost the same thing, but I find that, you know, you could form a lot of TPOs at a certain price, but there could be no volume there at all. But in general, where the market spends a lot of time, it also forms a fair amount of volume, so they're in alignment. But again, I prefer volume.
Okay. AH is asking if you can share this chart definition and presumably where he can get that.
All of my chart definitions for Linsoft or Market Delta charts are available to Stage 5 clients. I make everything that I do, including homework and all that stuff, available to those people. I used to post them on my site, but if you want to go to futurestrader71.com/contact and shoot me a message, I'll be happy to send you the chart definition. Otherwise, just put it in the AMA thread, and I'll respond there and give you a link to the definition, okay?
Okay. We got about 3 or 4 minutes left. Let's see what we can get to. Rex is asking, he says, if it's midday, and we have a P-shaped intraday profile, what kind of general expectation does this indicate? What about a B, as in boy-shaped profile?
Okay, good question. And you, most people probably need to look at webinar 2 on my website to kind of get this question, but I'll cover it here. Generally, wherever you have, like, for example, this profile here balanced all day long yesterday until it broke down. And before it came back on the close and traded all this, what you had was a P-shaped profile. I'll draw it here. It was, before this happened, it was a P-shaped profile that looked something like this, right? Like that. And if this happens on a break lower, it has a different meaning than if we opened down here and then started to trade up and then sat sideways to form that P this way. My markings don't stay on the chart because the chart's constantly refreshing. Those two mean two totally different things. If the market starts down here, has no volume, and then rips up to form the stem of a P, this stem here before the fat part, and then starts to chop, chances are what you're forming, to most people, that's going to look like a flag. What you're forming is a lot of potential, a lot of energy for the profile to extend up and flatten out. So what it'll end up looking like is flat at the bottom, P-shape, but then it'll flatten out at the top so that it's more of a curve like this, more of a normal and what's called Gaussian profile, Gaussian curve, right, statistical curve. But in this situation here where you have a lot of chop and it breaks away, the market's essentially telling you, hey, we're moving out of value. We like these prices. Now we've moved out of value. Chances are the market's not, before the session ends, the market's not going to come back in and chop around in here again. So the meaning of that P-shaped profile is different than one where we start here, chop around, build energy, and it's likely to continue higher because everybody that got short, as it climbed, And in here, remember, volume does not is not created unless a buyer and a seller interact with each other and trade. All the shorts that were part of this move up and part of this fatness here in the profile are likely to dissipate because a majority of the volume on the exchange is day time frame volume. Those guys do not want to cover margin for the night, and they end up flattening their position, which helps drive the market up. So, it's kind of specific, but for Rex's question, but the thing is, it makes a big difference how that profile is shaped. But to get the answer, it's not from a book, it's not because I told you so. To get the answer, always think in the perspective of, if you're a trader sitting in the middle of a pit where this trading happened, what would you be feeling, what would you be thinking as a day trader? And you'll get the answer, because that's how I get the answers. It's not from a book, it's just watching the market and trying to guess what my opponents are doing, because I'm trading against other people.
Okay. Jeff has a question. Do you use Fibonacci extensions to target areas that may, I'm not sure what he means, but to target like 161%, he's also listing 2 and 300%, which are not Fibonacci numbers. So do you Right. do anything like that?
Yes, I do. So, in projecting the next move up from this balance zone that started on the 18th, I have a Fib extension here at 100% and 162%, and that becomes the measured move number that I would tweet out. And I do use them when I run out of, when I don't have any profiles or whatever. Like right now, I have a projected, on the weekly, I think I have a projected target at 1840 based on the swing low pullback here and then projected upwards. It projects, I think, 1793 and a quarter, and it projects 1840, and those are Fib extensions. The only reason I use those extensions is because I don't have anything else. All I have is trend lines, patterns, and Fib extensions to predict or try to give me an idea of what to expect when we move away where there are no profiles. And that's how I use them. I wouldn't call them a tier one tool to use.
Okay. All right. I have one question of my own that you just kind of piqued my interest. You said something just a second ago that the majority of the volume are day time frame traders because they don't want to cover the margin overnight. Can you tell me, in your opinion, do you think this is how would you describe those traders? Would you talk about them or describe them as like retail, or are you saying that a lot of shops or institutions have the same philosophy?
It's actually a lot of locals. So I'll tell you this. This is a simple one. You can get the information on your own whenever you want to, which is my preference. So let's look for the ES right here. So this column is the, they took away the open interest. Interest right here. So the open interest in the ES is 2.8 million, okay? The volume is 1.22 million for that prior day. Yesterday it was at 1.55 million. This is the settlement data right out of the CME group. So you can see the open interest is that much. The volume is this much. Now what you do is you go to the next day. So when tomorrow comes, look at the open interest and keep this. Look at the open interest for tomorrow, and you'll see how much it changed. And what you'll see is that it doesn't change that much. It changes by a few hundred thousand. That's it. Yet we're trading anywhere between 1.1 and 1.7 million contracts a day in this product, okay? And most of that is just turnover and turnover and turnover. And it's not retail, because retail's not who's doing the bigger volume. It's the professionals. It is the tremendous number of prop shops, trade desks, arb shops, all that stuff. And those companies mostly, as far as I know, don't hold positions overnight. Why don't you want to hold those positions overnight? The main reason is it takes a lot of capital, because now you have to put up, what is it now, $4,500 per contract in the ES. You have to put that up with your clearing firm to hold a product that has almost a $90,000 per contract notional value. And so it does not make economic sense for these shops to have their traders trade that tremendous amount of volume. Some of these traders will trade 400 or 500 lots at a go, to all of a sudden put up, you know, $9 million, $12 million in cash to hold those positions overnight. They want to close them, which means they have to be closed by 4:15 Chicago time, and they open them up again at 5.
Right, especially when they can trade in and out of them for pennies and fees.
Yeah, yeah.
All right.
Exactly.
Thanks, FT. Guys, if you had any questions that did not get answered, you can go to FT71's AMA thread on Big Mike Trading. If you don't know where that is, just go to bigmiketrading.com. On the top right in the search bar, just type in AMA space FT71 and you'll find it. That's also where I will post the video here later today. Guys, we have one more AMA from FT. A lot of acronyms there. This year, I'm looking real quick. Let's see. It's on. It's 2 weeks from today on 10th of December, and that'll be it for this year. So stay tuned for that one. And then I hope everybody has a good Thanksgiving. This is the last event that we have before Thanksgiving. So, guys, hope you have a good time with your friends and your family. And we'll see everybody next time. Thanks, FT.
Thanks so much for having me on, Mike. Take care.